the counterattack playthrough series. We're going to be playing OCS Burma. OCS stands for Operational Combat Series. It's produced by Multiman Publishing. It's a game system for World War II and nearby conflicts like Korean War. This is the Burma module, and there are quite a few other modules. And we're going to get going with the first scenario. This first scenario is called Black Cats and White Tigers. It only uses a portion of the map, which I've outlined in red, as you can see. Though there are some units that start just outside that portion of the map. Let's take a look at the situation. It's basically the Japanese and British are fighting it out in... This would be northwestern Burma. Here we see a column of allied units. The sort of dark brown are Indian units, and the lighter brown British. They're all part of Great Britain, of course. So these units are sort of strewn across a mountain road here. And we have a bunch of Japanese units poised to attack. So the situation is that these guys are close to being cut off. They have this one road where they get supplies from. The Japanese are coming in here, down here, maybe over here. And the Japanese will win this scenario if they can destroy four or more allied units. The allies win if they only lose 2, 1, or 0, and if they lose 3, it's a draw. Japanese, they can lose as many units as they want. The objective is to destroy allied units. I've set this up per scenario instructions. There's not a lot of choices allowed. Basically, the position of all the units is pretty much fixed, but there are some choices. So the allies were able to set up first, and one decision they have to make for each unit is what mode it's going to be in. This game's a little different from other games, and it's actually the only one I know of, that the reverse side of a unit is not its damaged or reduced side, it's actually a different mode. So these units on their front side are in combat mode. So this guy's combat strength is 2, its movement value is 3. But if it were to switch over to movement mode, its combat value goes down to 1, but its movement increases to 4. So I guess you can think of combat mode as the components of the unit are in position to, I suppose, defend or in attack formation. They have the equivalent of, you know, throwing a picket line or skirmishers out, you know, World War II equivalent of that. Who knows? And then movement mode, maybe they're all in column and not guarding their flanks or something. But anyway, there's those two modes. I've gone ahead and set them all up in combat mode since in this scenario the Japanese go first. For the Japanese, I did mostly combat mode, but I did put a few in movement mode. I should point out I've never played this game. I actually find the rules to be a little rough for my little brain, so not so sure how it's going to play out. So I took some guesses at to what might make sense for movement mode versus combat mode. For example, this artillery unit here, its movement is 1, so I figured I'll start it in combat mode. Its range is pretty low, short. Other decisions to make, some units can start in reserve mode. That's another kind of mode. The allies have 3 reserve markers, the Japanese 2. The allies are not allowed to start with them on the map, but the Japanese can. Went ahead and marked this one in reserve here. We'll find out what that means, but, you know, reserves, I think they serve the purpose of what you might imagine. If there's a breakthrough in a line, the reserves might go through the breakthrough, or if they're the defender, they'd fill the gap. Who knows? Other things might happen here. And then there's a large stack of Japanese units here. There's one in there that I've marked in reserve. Other choices to make at setup. The Japanese get a truck unit for moving supplies around. I just set it over here. This is the Japanese supply source. It flows up this river. And they also get some mule teams for moving supplies around. So I set those up, and if the mule team or truck start with a supply depot, and we'll see all this in a minute, they can choose to be filled with supplies or not. I've filled them up. Allies also have a mule team. I think they're in this. It's in this stack. I started with it filled too. I don't think there are any other decisions to make. I think we'll get going without too many more descriptive descriptions of the rules. And see how it goes. So the first phase of a turn is the weather determination phase. This is sort of the turn tracking segment area of the board. This is March. March 15th. This scenario will go through the 29th. We can see when it first starts up, the ground state is normal as opposed to mud or quagmire, and weather's clear. So we're going to go ahead and see what the weather is. Come over to the weather chart here, and I roll two dice. And this is pretty bizarre. I need to pick one die as like the first die. So I have a white and a red. So I'll do white and red. Came out as 45. So what I think is strange is you don't add those numbers together. You treat them as 45. So in March, 45 falls into this range, clear weather. Okay, then we process what that means to the ground state. So I suppose if it's been raining for a while, weather, the ground goes muddy, but clear weather, I guess this is the current weather, it's clear. The previous weather was, ground state was normal, so clear and normal together make normal. That makes sense. So if it was, you can see here, if it was like raining hard, it would turn to mud. And there's also an effect on air operations. But when it's clear, you roll a 1d6, and it's always unrestricted operations. So that's pretty straightforward. The next thing we do is we determine the first player, except at the beginning of this scenario, the Japanese are first. Otherwise, we'd roll dice and figure that out. So then we start the first player's turn. And after the first player's turn, it'll be the second player's turn, and then it'll be the end of the overall turn, and then we start over with weather. We'll do that five times because there's five turns. So first thing we do is the aircraft refit phase. The Japanese have no aircraft in this scenario, so nothing to do there. Then the reinforcement phase. The Japanese, according to the scenario instructions, are going to accumulate some supplies every turn here. Two T of supplies. Just realize this truck should be flipped, talk about that in a minute, but 2T of supplies just accumulated right there. So what are 2T of supplies? Well, let's talk about supply. OCS is known for its supply rules. So these are a bunch of different supply markers. The basic unit is a supply point. So here's one supply point, 2, 3, 4, 5, it's different denominations. But supply points can be broken down into fractions. Basically, you can have supply points or supply tokens, T for token. And so a 1T is a quarter of a supply point. So tokens are 25% of supply point. So if you eat a token from this one supply point, you end up with 3 tokens left. And if you eat another one, you only have 2. Eat another one, you only have 1. So the Japanese accumulate 2T per turn. Maybe I should talk a little bit about supply before we go to the movement phase, which is next. So this game has some traditional supply rules in that, you know, a lot of war games you trace supply. For example, this is a supply source here, and you know, you might have to trace back to make sure you can draw a supply from the supply source. Lots of games do that. And after we move, we have to see if we can trace supply to a supply source. Now this is like an on-map supply source that accumulates supply. We can also have counters that represent supply sources. Those will be supply dumps, and that's what those supply points are. So if I had this counter here, that's a supply dump with two supply points, and that could be used as a supply source, but it would be consumed as it's used. Supply is also used when motorized or mechanized units are going to move. They have to pay supply to fuel up. Supply is also used during combat. You have to burn supply to attack and optionally to defend. So a lot of this game is, or what makes OCS special, is moving supply around and making sure you have it in the right spots. And there are places on the map where in other games you would just send your troops blazing down some road, but in this game, you know, I haven't played it yet, but my understanding is if you don't have a supply net set up properly, you can't go down that road. So I think we know enough about supply, at least for the moment, to start the first player's mode determination and movement segment. So there's a few things you do during this segment, but they're not applicable at the moment. The main thing, though, is we want to set the mode of our units, and then we can move them. For the Japanese, and it's only the Japanese because it's their turn right now, I think their mode is all set. I set it up at the start. But for the movement, we want to get them in position to do some tough work. I thought I'd point out the supply situation of these British that are down here, this column. Their supply source is here. I outlined it in red. And supply, when you trace it, you know, not when you're moving the counters around, but when you trace it, you trace it using truck movement points. And there's a few different rules, but basically, if you're tracing back to a supply source, it can be up to 5 movement points. And then if you have a headquarters, that can do some things to extend it, which we'll probably see. But And truck movement points on this kind of road in good weather, this is a fair weather road, it costs half a truck movement point. So, for example, let's pretend we're tracing supply. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So, perfect. They can trace right back to their supply source. Now, these guys here, they're just slightly too far, but that's okay. But the most important thing is that these guys are across a river with a bridge on a narrow road. Now, let's imagine there's some bad guys here and they wanted to try to trace supply around them back over to here or something. Well, how many movement points does it take a truck to go into mountains? Well, looking that up, they're prohibited. So in these mountains, tracing supply is brutal. It's right along these, only along the roads. Now there are these little other road-like things here. Those are called tracks. They're like just rough little mountain tracks. Might not be able to easily accommodate trucks even. They take 8 movement points. So, you know, trying to trace back here, even if it was allowed, the trace is not going to get very far. I mean, in fact, 5 movement points, it can't even get into one hex. So, all that is being said because for the Japanese, I think I want to try to get their units here to cut these guys off. So I need to kill 4 units. One nice thing about cutting off units is if they run out of supplies, their combat factor or combat strength is cut in half, which will make it easier for me to attack. You might notice here that all my units are battalions. That's what the two lines are there. I don't know if you can see that. Let's see here. The Japanese ones have these two vertical lines. That's a battalion. And a lot of the allies are battalions too. And you can see they have small combat factors. But some are have an X on them. That's a brigade. And so they're much tougher. So if I want to attack them, it'd be nice if they're out of supply. So let's see what we want to do here. So first, think we'll move these guys. So in a lot of war games, there's a concept of a zone of control, and this war game has it as well. A zone of control is the hexes surrounding a particular unit that it exerts its influence into, whether it can shoot there, it has patrols out into those hexes or whatever. And typically zone of control in many war games will stop supply from flowing through. That is true in this game. If there's no enemy unit, if there's no friendly unit in the hex where a zone of control is, supply can't flow through it, and it'll also stop units from moving. That's true to a certain extent in this game. There's three kinds of movement. White movement numbers are leg movement. Black, which there are some up here, that's truck movement. And I'm not sure if both colors here, it's like red on yellow, matter, but basically that is mechanized or track movement. So zones of control only affect truck movement. So all these units here are exerting zones of control across this river. But if since these guys are only leg movement, they can just ignore it and move. Speaking of zones of control, you can only exert a zone of control, I'm not sure if I said this, if you're in combat mode. So a unit that flips over to move mode to be fast ceases to exert its influence into neighboring hexes. All right, so let's get moving here. So this guy has three movement points. A track for infantry or for leg just costs one, so I can go 1, 2, 3. Now we're immediately blocking the supplies for these guys. So that's good. Here's a artillery in movement mode because they're just so slow. It is leg artillery, so we'll go ahead and move that over. 1, 2. I think I will stack it here. Stacking, it's a little odd. The most you can stack is 10 regimental equivalents. So 10 regiments. And a battalion in game terms is treated as half a regiment. So I can have basically 20 battalions stacked. Did I do that right? So anyway, we'll stack that there. I'm just trying to get some force there. This might be silly. I might be setting up something that's so easy to kill that it'll ruin the whole scenario, but we'll see. What do we have here? This is a supply point, and I put it on top of a mule team. So by doing that, it means the mule team's carrying it. There's some mule teams that actually, like the ones that can carry tokens, they'll have a full marker on them, in which case I don't have to like physically carry it around. I'm not sure why they didn't put them on all the transports, but it acts as a transport. So I want to move those supplies along with my guys so that it's easier to keep them in supply. So these zones of control from like this guy are exerted over here. So if he was trying to trace supply back to here, he couldn't because of the zones of control. You also use truck movement when you're drawing supply. So 5 points of truck movement can't even get into this hex. So we'll go ahead and mule team this over. It does count as a supply dump, even though it's loaded on the mules. It's also a supply dump when not, so I think we'll just set it there. You can always draw supply from an adjacent hex, even if you don't have enough truck movement points to get to it. Okay, these guys, they're in move mode. They're pretty weak in move mode. I'm trying to decide, do I want them up here? Maybe I'll go 1, 2, 3, 4, and then 5. Just try to make it tough for the allies to try to get back into supply. This might be totally sacrificing my units, I'm not really sure, but now this guy. 1, 2, 3. I can leave it here with the supplies. Let's see, I'm not sure if units are able to cross minor rivers. They are. So maybe it should hang out with the supplies to prevent these guys from hopping over the river. They probably won't anyway, but, you know, maybe I'll decide to do that. We'll see. So actually, I might be just totally bungling this right now. But we'll see how it goes. One thing, these guys are totally cut off from tracing supply back to a supply source. So all their supplies are carried on those mules. Let's go check out the tail end of the column. We have a couple engineering units, which I think just are treated as infantry, at least in this scenario. So this guy will go one. He could go here. He would then be out of trace supply because there's a zone of control into here. And I can bring this guy up and put him here. But instead, I think I'd rather just go one step and then stack them. That way if I am attacked, it's at 1-2 odds or whatever. Okay, what about over here? I have a few things going on here. So this guy is in reserve mode. Reserve mode, during the movement phase, you can move 25% of your movement if you want. 25% here is not very much. It's not even one movement point. But you can always make a minimum move, so he's just going to scooch like this. Then in your exploitation phase, which comes later in this turn, or on the other player's turn during the reaction phase, which we'll talk about, you can unleash your units from reserve, and then they can go full movement in exploitation, and in I think it's called reaction, they can go half, something like that. We'll see how that goes. So he's there. This guy has three movement points. We'll go one, two, and stack. I'm just going to offset it so I can remember the reserve guy. There's some artillery up here. In move mode, its range is one. In combat mode, looks like its range is also one. Range is the bottom number here. So these ranges seem really low. I think it's because the terrain is so dense, like the effective range has to be low. I don't know. So he can go three, one, two. Go ahead and stack here, three. Okay. Now, not sure what the next thing to do is. There's more Japanese units to move. Let's go dig into this big stack here. We have a headquarters. Yeah, let's talk about supply for headquarters. So when the supply phase comes up, this headquarters is going to also have to trace supply. Well, it can trace back to the supply source here. And let's say there's a unit, let's just say, I think these units can trace down to there also, but let's just say they're out of range of tracing to that supply source. Well, when I'm doing my supply checks, I can say, okay, this headquarters draws supply from the supply source, and then the rules call throwing supply. It can then throw it further, up to six movement points. You can't use that to move the physical supply counters around, but when you're tracing supply, a headquarters can throw it forward. So that's how you can sort of chain supply. So anyway, let's take this apart. Okay, so there's some artillery in there. They're in move mode. Oh, I have a guy set in reserve, and a couple mule teams loaded up. The F on these 1T mule teams means loaded up with one token of supply. So let's go ahead and do this reserve. I don't know if this is good or bad. I was thinking maybe I'd bring it up this road and then get onto one of these mountain paths and, I don't know, just come over here and try to cut off supply like way up here. It's probably not even enough time in the game to do that, but I'm just kind of playing around. So I can move 1/4 of my movement. I'm in move mode, so that's 1/4 of 6 is 1, because I round down. But 1 on a fair weather road is half a movement point, so I can go up to here. Okay. Just leave these unstacked for a second. Then I want to use these mules to get some supplies moving up. So they're loaded with 1Ts. I think we're going to take them up this track. So mules use leg movement. Leg movement on a track costs 1 point, so they can cruise up here and drop some supplies off. Now I also have a truck, and also when these guys want to trace supply, we use truck movement. But remember, truck movement on a track is 8 movement points, so these guys are already out of supply. They can't trace back to a supply source. The headquarters throws 6 movement points out. Well, this costs 8 just to go on. So these guys are just way out of supply. But these mules can help. So we can go 1, 2, 3, 4. And then I can spend a movement point to drop off the 1T they're carrying. So that's 5, and then go back 6. So I think I'll have this guy do the same thing. 1, 2, 3, 4, drop off, 5, 6. And so now we have 2T up here in the mountains. And there's also a supply dump here consisting of 4.5 supply points. So we'll take care of that. So I have a bunch of other things I need to do here, but one thing, I have all this artillery back here. It costs supply to use it when you're attacking. Also, it's motorized. Black numbers instead of white, so that means trucks. You have to fuel it if you want to move it. That's more supply. I think I do want to move it. Now, since they use trucks, coming up these tracks would take forever to get into position because their range is so low. But they could come along this improved road, or Fairweather Road, I think it's called, and yeah, come over here and maybe get in position to support an attack. If they just bombard someone here and inflict casualties, that's, you know, 1/4 of our way to victory. So I think we're going to do that. So there's a few rules for how you fuel things for movement. You can do each individually, and it costs 1T. Or you can pay a whole supply point to fuel the entire division within range of the headquarters anyway. And so since I have 4 artillery units, it doesn't really matter. It's going to cost 1 supply point either way. But also that supply point could be used to fuel the headquarters, which is also has truck movement. If it were to go into move mode, it can move 10 spaces, but it's not going to move, so it doesn't really matter. So I'm going to do that, though. I'm going to fuel the division. And I can do that. I can sort of mark it as having been fueled so that all these artillery units are ready to roll. So then I can go ahead and move 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I think that was 5 or 5.5. Didn't pay enough attention. And then I think they'll go ahead and move in here. So that's another half point. And then bring that other guy around. Stack it in there. It's quite possible I'm just wasting supply doing this because these guys will just move out of here and be out of range. But let's see what those other guys over here can do. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 7.5. Okay, so he's stacking up a big attack force. I don't know if this is how people play or not. I need to spend that 1 point to supply, so this 4 converts to a 3. So I just used up a ton of my supplies to do that. what else do we have to move around here? I think there's someone back here. Oh yeah, well we have a truck and an infantry unit here. I think this infantry unit's going to go into move mode. It's a 5. And maybe it'll go over to, I think it'll go up the road because I feel that track where the mules are is going to be tough to keep in supply. So we'll go 1, 2, 3, 4. And, you know, I keep forgetting there's aircraft. The Allies have aircraft. Maybe this is a juicy stack to bombard. Oh well, we'll find out if I'm doing horrible things here. So they'll stop there because I'm worried about that. Let's check out the supply situation for these guys for when the supply phase comes. They can use truck movement points for tracing supply. 1, 2, 3, 4. four and a half. So they can trace supply back. So they're good. So I don't need to try to put more supplies over here. The reason I'm mentioning that is I have this truck, and its job is to move supplies around. So maybe we'll use it to help stage supplies for the mules. So I'm going to go ahead and load it up for one. That's 45 movement points. Load it up for one, so that's one. And that means this 2T drops to 1T. And the truck is now carrying 1T. So it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 4.5. And then it can move up the road for 8. So the track, I should say. So that's 12.5. 20.5. Is that what I want to do? I guess so. Drop it off for a point. 21.5. 29.5. 30. 31. 32. 33. 33.5. Pick it up another one. 34.5. 35. 36. 37. 38. I can't quite get onto that track. I think we'll just drop it off here for 39, and then we'll go 40, 41, 42, and we'll wait for supplies next turn. So we added a T to this stockpile here, because I can get rid of this. I already know I paid. So I think I've moved every Japanese unit. Okay, so now we do the supply phase. So this is what sort of moving that supply around was getting ready for. So we're gonna see who can trace supply back to the supply source. So I think we already established these guys can trace back. The headquarters can, this guy. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So it has to be, it's 5 that we're looking for. These guys right out here though, they guaranteed to be totally cut off from the supply source. So what do they do? Well, they can trace supply to a supply dump, which we have in here. It's 1 SP, 1 supply point on the hoof. So what you do is you count up the total number of regiments and divide by 2, rounding up. So each one of these battalions is half a regiment. So 1, 2, 3, 4. So that's 2 regiments, the mules don't count, divided by 2 is 1T. Let me just double check to make sure I got that right.
I think I did.
So the rule is basically you eat 1T, 1/4 of a supply point, for every 2 regiments. That's why we were dividing by 2. And these are not regiments, though. They're battalions. They're treated as half a regiment. So we have 4 units. Divided by 2 makes it 2 regiments. Divided by 2 is how many T we need to eat. So this 1T gets partially consumed. Now it's 3T. Now in this game, this module from Burma has a special rule for the Japanese. They can forgo eating supply and try to forage. I think I'm going to just wait until I'm out of supply to try that. But, you know, there might be some strategy where you want to hold on to your supply and not forage. I'm not even sure if I have that rule right, so I'll just wait until they're starving. Okay, so the next chunk of questionable supply is back here. So mules don't need to trace supply. These guys do. So truck movement points, we need to go 5. Well, there's only 8. It takes 8 movement points just to get in here. So you can always go 1 space. It's assumed even if you can't get into the space, if it's adjacent, you'll figure out some way to get the supply. So they can draw supply from here. So we have, let's see here, I think it's three. So it's 1.5 regiments divided by 2 is 0.75, round up to 1. So that is also 1 T, so they consume this. So that's why I'm going to need those mules just going back and forth to keep these guys sustained. Okay, and I think everyone else is taken care of. So next segment is the reaction segment. This is where the enemy gets to do something during our turn. Basically, they can release reserves. They don't have any because they weren't allowed to set up with reserve markers. And conduct barrages with aircraft at least, possibly artillery. So I'll look up the artillery part, but let's take care of the aircraft part first. The Allies happen to have off-map air bases. They are over there. There's a bunch of aircraft there. And I think they say they are, I think they're 13, something like that, hexes away from like somewhere over here. So I counted it out earlier, and basically you can adjust their strength a little bit based on the range they have to fly, but this range doesn't matter. So basically we select some target hexes to do aerial barrages on. So I think the first one we want to do is this one because it's blocking our supply. So you can fly up to 4 aircraft units in a single barrage. And just looking at the barrage table, which I'll probably show when I roll, I think I want to just stack up a bunch of aircraft. So we'll do max of 4 aircraft. We got 2 Hurricanes fighters and a Vengeance tactical bomber and a Bowfighter tactical bomber. Okay, so, but the first thing we need to do is, it's assumed there's some flak capability in the hex, so we have to see if there's any flak. Now, if there were any Japanese aircraft, we might be doing some other things, but there aren't. So I roll 2 dice to determine flak, and if I roll an 11 or more, an aircraft takes a hit. And I have to add 1 to the die roll if there are 3 more aircraft. So okay, so it goes to 7. And there's a few other modifiers that do not apply. They have to do with like aircraft patrol zones and a few other things. So so no flak did not do anything. So now we're going to conduct a barrage. So we add up our barrage strength. It has a little bomb next to it. 8, 12 is 20. Plus 3 and 3 is 26. So I grouped these aircraft together for a reason. And that is because the barrage table has different strengths listed on it. And sort of different thresholds. And one of those thresholds is 25 to 40. So by getting over 25, I can use this column. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to roll 2 dice. Oh, got it. Boxcars on that one. That's going to be devastating. But there's some modifiers. So let's see, we're right here. So modifiers, I shift 1 left if there's a hedgehog. I'm just going to quickly cruise through these. Shift 1 left in close or very close terrain. So that's sort of how dense the terrain is. Looks like on the terrain chart, a mountain with a road is very close. Shift 3 columns left if there's no correct spotter adjacent to the target. Well, there is. The 63rd of the 17th Indian is there. Shift 1 column right if all the mission aircraft are really close to their base. They're not. And then shift 1 column left if they're far. They're not. So we got a 1 here. 1. Looking it up on a chart over to the side here. Oh, wait, hold on. There's some more shifts. If there's less than one regiment, there one or less, there is one or less. So I shifted another one left. That's still, let's see, that was one, two. So yeah, it's still a one. So I don't actually see what this says. I'm going to look it up. Ah, okay. One means you lose one step, and then the units become disorganized. In a barrage, I can choose which step takes a loss. You will find out in grand combat. It's not necessarily my choice. So I think we'll destroy the artillery. It's going to eat up supply anyway. It's not very good at defending. So destroyed. And then this guy becomes disrupted. Disruption's bad. Basically, your attack and defense strength and movement are halved. There's probably some other bad things about it, too. So that's good, because the allies... Well, I'm not sure if the sequence will make this work out, but the allies might be able to attack him and have a good chance of destroying him even easier. So now these aircraft, they all fly back to base, and they go into the inactive section of the base because they've already flown. The next air barrage. Yeah, totally screwed this up. That's the Japanese. It's coming in right here. Three Hurricane fighters and a B-25 tactical bomber. Not sure what the brown versus orange is. Maybe this is Army and this is Air Force. Not sure. So this is 17, 20, 23, 26 again. Going against this stack. Yeah, awful. So we'll go ahead and roll for flak. Rolled. 9 plus 1 for having an extra fighter. That's 10. Just barely missed it. So then we're going to go ahead and do the attack. Let me count how many regiments are in here. It's 1, 2, 3. Okay. Maybe I'll show the barrage table one more time. Afterwards, I'll just kind of tell you what's going on. So, rolling two dice. Rolled a 6 on this column. 6 right here. Let's see. Shift 1 left for close or very close terrain. Yes. I have a good spotter. The density of the target, we determine there are 3 regiments. If there's greater than 1, up to 3, there's no shift. Okay, so it's DG. So that could have been much worse for the Japanese. But this entire stack is in disorganized mode. And I was hoping they would be bombarding and attacking there. That might not happen, but I'll have to add it up and see what happens. Okay, so those aircraft fly back to base. Now, I know the Allies have some artillery. Let me see if it's bombard capable during this phase. Yep. The artillery can be also be used during this reaction phase. So I think it was in here, yeah. Now that is a pretty powerful artillery piece compared to the Japanese ones. It has a range of 2, strength of 24. I should make sure I have the spotting rules correct. I'm assuming this guy who's adjacent can spot for it across this river. Another thing that might be good to bombard is this guy over here. So trying to keep the door open here. So let me just do one more check. Yeah, that's it. You just need a friendly unit adjacent to the target. So the question is, what is the target going to be here? I think it's going to be this guy. So by the way, those aircraft, there's special rules for that off-map airbase. They don't have to take any, they don't cost any supply. Artillery though, just like other combat units on the board here, does take supply. Now it's motorized, but does not need to be fueled. It's not moving. But it needs to be supplied for an attack. I'll look that up in a second, but it's got a supply. It's sitting on a supply stockpile. Okay, so how many regiments are over here? We have, so this stuff doesn't count here. We have half a regiment. Okay, so we'll have a negative shift because there's not that many units there. That's okay. I already called it. So I'm going to look up on the barrage table. And, you know, one last time over here, I'll show it because there's a little difference that I'm doing this time. Okay. So 24 is right here. So too bad I couldn't get one more point to go to this next column, but 24. And there's actually a cost associated with this barrage, 3T. So I'm going to have to spend 3T to do this barrage. I'll go ahead and roll first. Okay, got a lot of doubles, but basically rolled a 4. Doesn't even matter. I'm going to get one shift left. It's in close terrain, yeah, so no effect. So just from a bad roll. We do need to spend that 3T though. We'll leave the T that are on the, we'll leave the supply point that's on the mules here. We'll take the 3T from here, so we'll drop this to 4. And then add a T to it if I can find one somewhere. Here we go. So that was a waste of 3T. I'm betting on these guys escaping though, so it's okay if they're using up the stockpile. Okay, let's throw that guy back there. No more British bombardments, so their reaction phase is over. Okay, the next phase is the Japanese combat phase. But let me make a correction. I was using, I was paying one movement point for my truck to load and unload supplies. It's actually 5% of the, I think it was 10%. I don't know. I forget. I looked it up and basically it costs 5 points to load and unload from this truck. So I just kind of redid all the movement and drop off. And so instead of dropping supply off here, I dropped it off in this hex. And then the truck went and got the other one, brought it back here and kept it here loaded. So that was an error. Now the mules only cost 1. So 1 for the mule, 5 for the truck. Okay, Japanese are on the attack. In the combat segment, you first do barrages and then the actual ground combat. So I was hoping to do a little more, be able to do a little more down here. But that bombardment, which is of course silly of me to make a juicy target for Japanese, really reduce this, the power of this stack. So everything is reduced by half. The strength, the movement. So I think though, I'm still gonna attempt to do a barrage with this artillery. The barrage strength is 6, 7, 8, 9, cut in half, 4.5, that goes down to 4.5, whole number 4. So the barrage strength is 4, and that's not a lot. But there's a chance I can disorganize this guy and make it a little easier to attack. Again, this is probably really stupid, but whatever. So let's see if we can pay supply. I'm looking at a barrage of 4. It's going to cost 2T. So they need to, this can't be trace supply where you trace back to like the supply source. It has to be like physically on the map counter. So I believe I can do this, and I'm just going to double check, but this headquarters has some supply in there. In fact, it has 2T right there. It can throw it up to 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Now, I'm going to go see if that's okay, but if I didn't throw it, could this guy draw it? 1, two, three, four, five. Yes. So I guess I won't look it up yet. So that guy's going to draw 2T. Burnt forever. To do a barrage. Again, we're going to do a barrage with 4. Rolled 4. Basically, after taking into account column shifts and stuff, I needed to roll either a 10 or an 11 or something. So that was just a waste of supply. So that barrage is over. Is there another barrage I want to do? I don't think so. We have some really weak artillery here. I'd rather flip it to its slightly stronger side and see what's up. Plus there's no supplies up here. I don't know. Okay, so I guess that's the end of the barrage segment, and now we'll go into the combat segment. Not sure if I'm going to do any. So this guy's, there's two strength units in here, so they cut in half to one each, so that'd be a 1-to-1 in tough mountain terrain. I think I would be asking for death if I did that. Over here, same thing. These guys are just so weak. These would be attacking across a river, or I guess what is that? That's a minor river. So that'd be bad. These guys are so weak. So I think these guys, their job is not to fight. Their job is to block supply. So I think that is the end of the Japanese combat phase. Now for the exploitation segment. This is where units that are released from reserve can move, barrage, combat. So we have this guy in here. I'm going to release him. And he can go his full movement of 3. So I probably should have had him in move mode and he could have come up this track and tried to get back here. But instead, I think I'm going to just have him minimum move and hop the river. Okay, put this guy back here. We had another guy in reserve. Might as well release him too. So I'm going to release so he can go 6 moves. I'm going to go 1, 2, 2.5, 3.5, 4.5, 5.5. The long, windy trail. And there's a unit that got out of place here. Okay, so that is the Japanese turn. There's a cleanup phase that I'm not sure what I'm supposed to do. Let me go check that out. Okay, cleanup is simply, for this scenario, removing your disorganized markers. Okay, now for the Allied turn. First thing we do is the aircraft refit phase. Normally you'd spend supply, I believe, to get your aircraft back into active status. I'm moving them from inactive to active. That off-map base, or those bases, have their own supplies source, so I don't have to worry about that. Then reinforcement phase. There are no reinforcements, but the Allies do get 2 SPs per turn. They get them right here. It's a little bit of a supply dump there already. Okay, then we're going to go into mode determination and movement. Okay, these guys need to break out. They're currently cut off from supply. And they need to do it before or without taking losses, because they can only take a few losses before losing the game. So I think we want to try to consolidate them over here so they make for tougher nuts to crack. There are no Japanese aircraft to barrage them. There are some artillery, though. But they can get out of range of the artillery that's here. So I think they're just going to try to pile up over here. What about this artillery unit here? Maybe we'll leave it there for a second. Let me see what we have under here. We have a battalion. We have our stockpile. A couple more battalions. They're all kind of weak looking. 2 brigades. They're still one-step units. They're just tougher. So maybe we'll stack these brigades together to make for a good punch to punch out. they would be punching across the river. That's probably half attack strength, I'm guessing. But let's see. A brigade is equivalent to one regiment in the game terms of this game anyway. So it's two regiments. We can have up to 10 stacked. So many. So maybe we will pile the rest of these guys up over here. You know, I'm kind of neglecting something. I could be placing right now reserve markers. Let me just make sure I understand the rules for placing reserve markers. Yeah, so these guys could enter reserve mode. I have three reserve markers. Doing that would allow, for example, this stack to punch a hole. Maybe someone else would punch a hole, and then the reserve markers can flee out, I believe, of the trap. So you can't place a reserve marker on a unit that is in zone of control, but I could place one here. So maybe I'll do that. Oh, and you can also enter either combat or move mode. I think he's going to enter move. Just eke out an extra movement point there. In reserve, I have two more reserve markers to place. Now I could place them on this stack. So I'll just kind of keep that stack off to the side. I think I'm going to move the do some movement of this stockpile. So this is currently being carried by a mule. So maybe we'll go, I'm going to take it off the mule for a second. It's going to go one, two, three to drop it off. I'll just throw it underneath here. Then four, five, six to pick up another chunk. So this four goes down to three. There's a little change in there. And it's now, there's a 1 point, a supply point stacked on top of the mule. Okay, so I think I'm gonna put these guys in reserve mode as well. Well, at least this guy. So he's gonna go in reserve mode. What about the artillery? I might wanna do a barrage with the artillery. I think the artillery will stay out of reserve mode. Now, let me put these guys back here. So this guy's going to stay in combat mode. Go one, two, three. Okay, still have something else that can go use reserve mode. Let's go move some other things before I decide. So there's an armored unit here. Sorry for the horrible camera work here. Also off the play area, there are some reinforcements coming in. They've already expended movement points. I need to look up how much they've already expended. Okay, each one's expended a different number of movement points, and some of these guys are mech, or I should say tracked or truck type movement, but since they have already spent movement points, I'm going to assume they've already been fueled. It doesn't really say it in the scenario, but I think that makes sense. These are units that were in movement on the way to the battle area at the beginning of the scenario. So let's go ahead and move some of these guys up. We'll start with this guy here. So who is that? That's the 37th, the 23rd Infantry. He has already expended 1.5 movement point factors, movement points. So we have 3.5 left. We'll go 1, 2, using leg movement here. And he's pretty weak. Maybe I'll send him up to defend this area up here. So actually, let me remember what I did. I went 1 to 2, so I can go three, and that 0.5 that I lost. Okay, so now this is the 219th HY, maybe that's Hyderabad or something. They have spent 3.5 movement points, so that's interesting. They'll go 0.5. Let me make sure I'm reading that correctly. Yeah, already used 3.5. Okay. The rules explicitly state these guys come in on movement mode, by the way. Okay, how about this artillery unit? The artillery unit has spent 5 movement points, so it has 7 left. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Just keep it there. And then we have an armored unit back here. 7 movement points have been expended. It has 11. 1, 2, 3. I'm just making sure I'm using the right movement rate. I am. This is an all-weather road. 4, 5, 6. Let's see. 30 spent 7, so I can do 3 more. 7, 8, 9. Okay. Now there's 2 units that haven't moved yet. The tank over here, and this looks like a machine gun type battalion, so I guess like heavy weapons battalion. I was thinking I'd like put the reserve marker on this armored unit over here. Instead, I think it should attack this guy. So I'm gonna fuel it up. Need to find some fuel. Hold on, there's a counter disaster off the edge of the camera. Okay, so we're gonna fuel this guy up. It's gonna cost 1 T. Here's a 2. Okay, flip it to 1, so this guy's fueled up. Okay, he's gonna go 1, 2, 3, 3.5. Now I wanted to talk about concept of an overrun. So we saw the Japanese, they moved up next to units, and then later during the combat phase they attacked. So I can move up here and then later in the combat phase attack. But there is the concept of an overrun, which is basically an attack while you're moving. There's some special rules to it, but basically during an overrun you can get you have a high chance of surprise. You know, and actually, now that I think of it, I actually didn't do any ground combat last turn, so we didn't see that. But basically, there's overruns during movement and then general combat. And there's a chance of surprise in either one of those. But when doing overruns, there's a higher chance of surprise. So to do an overrun, I need to pay 3 movement points to basically enter the hex that this unit's in. And then we do an attack. The problem is you can't overrun into a hex. Well, you can't count the roads when you're doing an overrun. I guess you fanned out on either side of the road and you're attacking. And so you have to look at the terrain and see, make sure the terrain you're entering costs 3 or less to enter. Well, this is tracked movement, and tracked movement into a mountain is prohibited. So I cannot overrun. So he'll just stop there. And then maybe this machine gun will come up here. I'm a little nervous about this attack. But I think I should probably do this attack. What I'm nervous about is just a single bad roll is going to lose me a unit. Okay, so I've moved everyone. And I guess this one reserve marker is not going to end up being used. Yeah. So, the next step is the supply phase, where we're going to check supply. So we need to trace supply. Let's do the easy ones here. So we need to trace 5 movement points back. 1, 2, 3.5. So cool. This is truck movement. If I was going to follow this track using truck movement, it would be 8. Which he only has 5 supply movement points available. However, you can always trace to an adjacent location, even if the terrain is prohibited. The rules say like the troops will figure out some way to get those supplies if they're right next to them. Now the rules aren't really specific about like this guy out here. It's out of the play area. I'm just gonna assume it's in supply, but just for fun, let's just see if we can trace one. So I guess I'm moving him in the wrong direction since there's tracks down there. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Yeah, he is not in trace supply, but, you know, in the reality, there's tons of supply in this area. You know, this is just an off-map area where there are other combatants and supply infrastructure. So it's just the nature of a small scenario. Okay, so all those guys can trace supply. Now what about these guys? Well, they can't trace it back to a normal supply source, so they have to eat supply from the map. We basically take total number of war regiments and divide by 2. So this is 1 regiment and 2 regiments. All these guys can trace to this supply source. But you know what? I don't want to use that supply source. I want to use the one here that I haven't moved. Let's eat up the stuff that's more likely to be captured. Just making a little mess here. So let's see. 1 regiment, 2 regiments. 2.5, that's a battalion. Let's see, this is another brigade, so 3.5. And then that's a battalion, so 4. Mules don't count. So that's 4 regiments divided by 2 is 2T. So we'll eat 1T here. And then this 3 drops to a 2. And we should have 3T change. So they're getting close to being out of supply, but that mule still has supply on it. What did I have here? I think I had the mule here. This guy in reserve. And the artillery on top. Okay, everyone supplied there. I don't think I counted this guy. Let me just do a quick count. Yeah, I think I should have eaten 3T. So, you dig through this stack here. I'm not a fan of super high stacking games, but this one's tolerable so far. Okay, let's see. Where's my mule? Supply. This guy that's in reserve. And the artillery. Okay, everyone is in supply. Okay, then we do the reaction phase where Japanese reserve units and aircraft can do things. And I guess artillery too. So I think there might be an artillery barrage. One thing the Allies are going to have to do though, and a reason the Japanese wouldn't want to move some units even if they could, they can't right here, but is that a Japanese unit, a battalion that does not move, starts a movement phase, and then at the end of the movement phase has not moved, can fortify. I think it's called building a hedgehog. So that would be bad. So if the Allies can't clear these guys out, those Japanese can hedgehog and make it even tougher to get out. But anyway, let's see. I think the Japanese, they want to do a barrage. Now there's no spotter on this guy. And I know I have artillery here. It doesn't have a very good range. You know what? Maybe I can't. You know, it's still in move mode, and the range while in move mode is 1 for these guys. While in non-move mode, or combat mode, it goes up to 2. So, I guess probably it's kind of wasteful to do an attack until I get these artillery units into combat mode. And even then, it might be wasteful. Okay, so the Japanese aren't doing anything for their reaction. So, we're going to do the Allied combat segment. It starts with a barrage segment. So we can barrage with artillery. We can also call in our aircraft. Remember on the Japanese turn, we called them in during the reaction phase. Well, if we call in our aircraft now, depending on the circumstances, but basically they pretty much won't be available on our reaction phase during the Japanese turn. Maybe we have a pretty good artillery unit here, so maybe we'll bombard with it to bombard one of these guys and then do an airstrike with some of these. Be nice to try to get another hit on these guys because they're so stacked up. I would get, I think, a 3-column shift for not having a good spotter. Without a really good roll, it's unlike, you know, I could end up just wasting the attack. So I think I'm going to keep 1 stack of air units in reserve for reaction. So here, Here comes our air units. They're going to, I think we'll have them bombard here. And maybe, oh wait, this guy, oh, you know, he can only go, it only has a range of 2. So I guess he'll bombard there. In that case, I'm bringing all the aircraft in because I want to clear these two guys out. I could spread them out. I don't have to do four aircraft per attack, but I'm just worried about these guys being cut off and eventually running out of supply. So let's do this attack first. We got two Hurricanes, a Vengeance, and a Bowfighter. Let's go ahead and roll for flak. Rolled a 4 plus 1 for more than 3 aircraft. Nothing. Okay. So they're going to hit this location. This is a mountain terrain with a track in it. Mountain terrain with a track. All right, hold on here. I'm just very close to road and hex. Okay, so I don't think it counts as very close terrain here, but the rules say this counts as instead of extreme terrain, if there's a road, it's just very close terrain, which is still pretty extreme. But I think the track, I seem to recall reading, tracks do not count as roads when you see the word road. This is going to be extreme terrain. The mule doesn't count. So there's 1 battalion here. So it's kind of a tough attack. And so what do we have here? 3, 6, 14, 26. I'm not going to bother showing the combat results table. Rolling 2 dice. Rolled 8. 8 on the 25 to 40 column. It's looking pretty good, but then I want to shift 1 column left. 2 columns left because it's extremely close. Okay, so it went down from possibly inflicting harm to just a disorganized result. But then there's 1 or less regiments because there's only a battalion, so that shifts 1. Still good though. And I'm just seeing what else we have here. Yep, so we're good. So that's disorganized. So I'm digging out a DG from my jar. Okay. So yes, we hit these guys. Sorry, this artillery's going here. So I did the wrong one. I'm hitting these guys with the aircraft. The artillery's going over here because it's 2 spaces away. Okay, so that's good. It's organized. These aircraft fly back unscathed to their base. They're in the inactive section. Okay, now this pile of aircraft is going to hit here. They are 3 Hurricanes and a B-25. That's 9 plus 17 is 26. Let's go ahead and do our flak roll. Flak is 6 plus 1, 7. I need an 11 to get a hit. Okay, so this guy is in very close because he's on a real road as opposed to just a little track. Roll a 9 on the 25 to 40 column. There's only 1 battalion, so move left 1. We're in very close. Move left. So it says 1/2 in brackets. So let's see. That says I roll a die. On a 4-6, the enemy loses a step and becomes disorganized. Otherwise, it's just disorganized. So let's see if I roll a 4-6. Rolled a 4, so they're disorganized. So this allied attack is going well, I think. We'll see. So he's disorganized. Oh, wait a minute. 4-6 is lose a step and be disorganized. He only has 1 step. Boom, dead. Okay. It's interesting. The defense strength is irrelevant for a barrage. Now on the chart, there's a bunch of 1/2, some of them are in brackets, so let me just make sure what the bracket versus non-bracket is. If it's in a bracket, it says something basically like, if it's you're in a hedgehog or it's a shore bombardment from ships or you don't have a spotter, it's just disorganized, otherwise treated as a regular old one slash or one half, which means there's a 50-50 chance of getting a hit. So we're good. So aircraft fly back. Okay, now for the barrage here. Seems very difficult for the Japanese. So this guy, he's going to do a 24 level strength barrage on here. Already established, that's a single battalion, so half a regiment. He needs to pay some money, some supply. On the 24 column, that's 3T. Ooh. Don't recall if I paid that last time, but I must have. So let's dig down into here. Here's 2T. Take one away from this to make it a 1. I should have 3T left over. Oops, that's not a 1. I should have 1 plus 3T left over. Slowly running out of supplies here. We're good, even if we're cut off for another turn. Okay, we're paid up. Let's do our barrage. It's a 6. A 6 on the 17 to 24 column. It's DG, but the density of the target is low, so that's a shift left. Still DG. It is extremely close terrain, shift out. That shifts us out into no effect. Okay, that's all the barrages. So now we do combat. Allies will do combat. It's unfortunate that these guys are here and this got destroyed. Maybe I should have bombarded something else because they could have just attacked and advanced after combat. I don't want this guy to like retreat this way. I'll have to look up the rules for retreat if there is one. But so let's do this attack here. So these guys, it's 12 strength points. Now, I need to look up, what does it mean to be DG? I think it's, if I recall correctly, it's your half. I think it's this. Yeah, I remember now. Being DG, or disorganized, your attack strength is halved, so it's a 1. Your combat strength, I should say. Your movement points are halved. And your, what is that called? That is your action rating. That's sort of like your readiness, your, you know, training, just how good... It's quality. It basically boils down to quality. It's reduced by 1, so it's a 3. So, let's see. This might be a little slow, so I apologize. So, first combat sequence. We have to spend SPs. I have to look up on a supply table. So, the attacker pays 1T per attacking step. Okay, well, we have 2 steps here, so I have to pay 2T. Rather than spend it from that, I'm going to draw it from over here. So dig back down in here again. Oy, oy, oy. That's why I don't like big stacks. Okay, so this 3T goes down to 1T. Okay, so attacker has paid. Okay, and then the defender can choose to pay or not. All right, let me just take care of business here. Defender can choose to pay or not. If they don't pay, their combat strength is cut in half yet again. So this guy would be down to 0.5. I mean, he'll probably pay. One interesting thing, which I haven't talked about, is all these units are carrying internal stocks. So they're already carrying supplies with them. So even when they run out of supplies on the map, they can still survive a little bit. But you're not allowed to pay from internal stocks for combat. Let me make sure that's true for defense. Yeah, so if the defender chooses to spend supply, they cannot use internal stocks. But the defender can choose not to supply the attack. The attacker must supply the attack. I just found one T way over there. I think it fell out of here. Oh, no, it's in the right spot. Never mind. Just had too many counter disasters here. Okay, so this guy, he's going to pay a T to defend. Let's see, is that true? Oh, 2T per combat for the defender. But if it's one regimental equivalent or less, it costs 1T. It is half a regimental equivalent, so we'll spend right off of this mule here a T to go down to 2T. These guys are almost out. They're almost dead, too. Okay, so this guy's supplied. So next step, the attacker and defender, attacker first, identifies the action rating they're going to use from one of their units. So basically, you pick a unit. It's sort of like going to be the lead unit in the attack. So, and its action rating could give it a benefit in the attack. Basically, if your action rating is greater than the other player's action rating, you have a benefit. So it doesn't really matter here. Both of these units are the same. So we'll use this top guy, his action rating of 4. Defender, there's only one defender. If there are more, we'd have a little choice, but it's 3. So 4-3. The defender then announces the terrain choices to be made. So what it does is it gets to pick the terrain the attacker has to be penalized for. So it's kind of unique in of all the war games I've played, I think. So this attacker's like, just imagine a bunch of trucks and guys cruising down here, right? They can be coming across the river when the battle starts, or they can get across into the mountains where the battle starts. So the defender can choose to meet them at the river, you know, all inside this hex, or wait until they're in the mountains. And so what I want to do is go see, okay, which one of them is better as the defender. So attacking across a river, looks like for foot movement, it's at half, the attacker gets half strength. I should look up if a bridge matters. I will. I don't think it does. Let's see. Oh, this is a minor river, and it's still half. Okay. Then the defender chooses what terrain they're going to be in, and it only counts, you can't count hex sides, it's just what's in the hex. And this one's all mountains, but there are some hexes where there's other terrain. So, okay, so they chose to use the river, because a mount attacking into a mountain with infantry is no penalty. So they're going to meet them at a river. I just want to see if the bridge matters. Well, I can't find any mention of bridges. I'm just going to imagine they're like a road. I mean, it's a bottleneck, so it can't have any good benefit for attacking. So, okay, so we got that figured out. So next, we're going to determine the die roll modifier for the attack. It is the action rating of the highest action rating subtracted from the lesser. So 4 minus 3, remember this guy's DG, is 1. So the attacker is going to have a plus 1 die roll modifier, I believe. Okay, then we have to check for surprise. This is a little tedious, but I think it's just because I'm learning it, and normally this would flow pretty well. So I'm going to roll for surprise. So I rolled a 7. And you add the action rating differential, so 7 plus 1 is 8. And I see this is a regular attack as opposed to an overrun attack. I need a 10 or more to get surprise. If I rolled low, I would have to, like 5 or less, the defender would have surprise. And it's just slightly easier in an overrun. So no surprise either way. Okay, and then finally, we roll on the combat results table. Now, so that die roll modifier for the action differential, that 4 minus 3, is used for determining surprise and for the combat roll itself. So it seems kind of important. So I rolled a 6. Let me go see. We haven't seen the combat results table yet. It's pretty intense here. Hopefully you can sort of see that. Okay, so we are in very close terrain right here. This is kind of similar to another game I've played, Next War Korea. I wonder if it's one of, I'm sure maybe Next War Korea borrowed from this. So very close terrain. The odds, combat odds, were 12 attacker strength, cut in half to 6 because of the river, against 1 defender strength. What does that mountain do for the defender? Looks like nothing. So that's a 6-1 odds in very close terrain. So here's 6-1. I rolled a 6. Come down to 6. Plus 1 for the die roll modifier. So that's a little cryptic. A01, D01. So the basically, it'll say like, you can have it, and it's the format is basically attacker A, then number of mandatory losses, there aren't any, and then an option 1, and then the defender, number of mandatory losses, none, option 1. So they're both option 1, and the attacker has to process that first. Option 1 means you have the option of either taking 1 step loss or retreating 1 hex. So that is bad for the attacker. Another part that's bad is that the defender, if the attacker completely retreats, I'm pretty sure the defender does not have to even bother with their option. So I'm in the situation where if the allies want to break out, they have to sacrifice a step. Because if they retreat, this guy will just stay here. And then, their supply will be withering. That'll be bad. So I'm going to risk. I've just given up only 1 more point, and I can't. One more of these that dies, and I can't win. I'm just going to risk it. Can't win as the allies. So, okay. So they took that. So now the defender has an option of retreat or take a step loss. Now this guy's DG, that might have an effect. I don't know which direction you have to retreat in. Do you have to go again towards a friendly or something? So let me go look that up. Okay, I think I got this. This is even better for the allies. So this guy can take a loss, in which case he'd be eliminated, or he can retreat. Now, if you retreat into an enemy zone of control, regardless of the presence of friendly units, you become disorganized. If you're already disorganized, you take a step loss. If there's a stack of units here, like 5 units all retreating, only one, you'd have to take 1 step loss total. Not all 5 would die, but in this case, there's only 1 step. This guy's dead. Now, if you were able to survive and retreated like into here, all these guys would be disorganized. So that's interesting, sort of the chaos of the retreat. Okay, so this is destroyed. Now advance after combat. I'm pretty sure those guys can advance because they were successful. Not so sure about the river part. Let's check it out. Well, there's nothing indicating the river would stop it, so they're going to go ahead and advance. Not so sure if that's a good idea. They've broken out, but leaving a supply dump there unattended, but during the reserve release, we'll get some guys over there. Okay, so now we go into the exploitation segment. The first part of that is movement. So we can release reserves if we want and move them. So I'm going to go ahead and do that. I'm going to release these reserves first. They can go 4, so we'll go 1, 2, 3. Okay, so those guys got out of the noose. You know, maybe they're going to go 3.5. Sorry, I'm not even showing you what's going on there. So they went to 3, and then I made them go 3.5. I'm a little worried about the Japanese maybe cutting across the mountains here, so maybe they'll come over here and try to defend. We We have some more reserves in here. I put one unit down in here in reserve. Let's go ahead and release. I'm a little worried by me moving these all these guys out. I'm just leaving the guys behind vulnerable to attack. But this guy's can go 5, so we'll go 1. I could stop there to protect the supply dump, but risk being attacked. But these guys can also be attacking too. They could be getting in position to attack. Don't think I want to do that though. I think I'm going to get them out as well. So let's see, that was 1, 2, 3. And I'll go 4, 5. Well, it's going to be hard to supply them, so I'll go 4. Is that what I want? It's going to be too hard to supply. Just keep them there. And did it to you again. They moved and joined these guys over here. And I was thinking of moving them here, but or even here. It's just going to be too tough to supply them. I don't have mules. I have some mules down here, but they're not over here. Okay, reserves have been released. I did the movement. Next step is barrage. Now, if I had any aircraft left, they could barrage now. If I had any artillery in reserve, they could barrage, but I don't. So next is combat. Only released reserves can do combat, and I move them away, so no combat. And then the cleanup phase. That's the end of the Allied turn and the Japanese turn. Cleanup phase, you basically remove DG, what's it called, disorganized counters from your units. And then it's end of turn. Catch you on the next installment.